morning everyone. My name's Rob, and I'm going to give you a bit of insight into the work I've been doing on the development of liquid processable BT resin systems. So I'll start off with just explaining what a BT resin is. And it's basically a combination of two different monomer building blocks, so a cyanate ester on the left here and a bismaleimide resin on the right. And these two systems both have desirable properties, which by combining them together, we can hopefully make a resin that displays both. So in this instance, we're looking at good electrical properties, so low dielectric constants, which arises from the cyanate ester, and also a high temperature performance, so high TGs, high glass transition, and that is provided by the bismaleimide. And so this combination of high temperature performance and good electric performance leads to their use in microelectronics and stealth applications, and they are relatively well used. However, there are a few obstacles into their further widespread use, and one of the main ones is their poor processability. In order to be able to actually make a composite out of these materials, you either have to use toxic solvents in order to blend them, or very high temperatures to get them to melt. So we're trying to develop liquid processable systems which could be more easily applied onto fibers. So this is kind of the concept of what I've started off doing. At the top here, we have the current industry standard monomers. So in the case of cyanate, you've got a melting point of 80, which isn't too bad, but that's the thing that requires horrible solvents in order for you to dissolve it. The BMI has a really high melting point of 160, which is a lot higher than you really want to be processing at. And furthermore, it's derived from a very toxic material called MDA, which is a carcinogen, so industry is reluctant to kind of use monomers that have come from this material. So our idea is to just slightly alter the chemistries to change the materials and make new systems while hopefully maintaining or improving on the original properties of the system. So we're using a cyanate. All we've done is remove one functional group, but this makes it liquid at room temperature. So straight away, we're imparting some improved processability. And we're switching out the BMI for a lower melting system, which is much less toxic than the original. And so what happens when we blend these two together? So these can be blended at about 120 degrees, and they form a homogeneous liquid blend, which remains liquid when you cool it down back to lower temperatures, as you can see in these rheological results here. So this is viscosity against temperature, and these are two different systems of different ratios of the components. And you can see here, at room temperature, 25 degrees, we're well below 1,000 millipascal seconds, which is your sort of high benchmark for an infusion process. So we're talking epoxy-like processing at very low temperatures. And in fact, early trials of infusion have shown that we're able to infuse these materials onto glass fiber rapidly at room temperature and then cure it afterwards. Some more uncured properties can be shown by the DSC results. So here's a range of different blends, starting from the neat cyanate ester at the bottom and progressively adding more of the bismaleimide component. And you can, interestingly to note here is that there's no melting transition at all between 0 and 125, almost 150, especially in the low BMI content blends. So this means you've got a large liquid processing window, so anywhere between room temperature and up to 150, you can play with your resin, do whatever you need to do with it. Hopefully it will have a good shelf life as well at these times. And another interesting thing to note is by adding the BMI component, we're actually shifting the exothermic cure peak to lower temperatures. So this means that there might be opportunities to cure at lower temperatures or use shorter cure cycles, which again is advantageous. So what actually happens when you do cure these materials? Well, here's a picture of a sample here. If you get homogeneous resin systems, and we've also included here some DMA results to compare to the current industry standard, which is seen here in black. So this dotted line is the storage or like elastic modulus of the material, and you can see at 100 degrees, very similar to our system, which is this top row of the table here. And when there's a very similar onset of degradation of that stiffness, which occurs about 250, so we're at least competitive with the industry standard. And then the actual degradation is much less severe. And in terms of the tan delta peak, we're shifting it significantly to higher temperatures. So yeah, we're competitive at the moment with what's going on in industry. This leads on to what comes next. So there's still quite a lot of work to do. We're still at an early stage. The next thing is to finish off the characterization of the neat resins. So things like the dielectric constant, which is obviously going to be important thinking about the electrical applications. Have we altered that in a negative way? And moisture absorption as well. Another problem with these systems is their brittleness, so we can try some different toughening mechanisms, see how well they work with these, in order of maybe looking in more structural direction. And then finally, adding them into composites, so glass fibers, carbon fibers, evaluating how easy they are to make, how well they perform, and then looking at the interface between the fiber and resin, which for these resins has never really been looked at in that much detail. So thanks everyone for listening. If you have any questions, ask now, or come and find me by my poster in the hall later. Cheers.